This is a saving message, a loving message, a message that should empower us to do more for the kingdom. Because although yesterday did not happen, as much as we're disappointed about that, there is going to come a time when it's going to stop. Amen? It's going to stop. Our opportunities to serve the Lord, our opportunities to share the gospel, our opportunities to get out there and give everything that we've got is going to stop. This is our shot. This is our opportunity to get out there and see the broken heart restored. To see the relationship that is severed from God reconciled. This is our opportunity to see the downtrodden lifted up. This is our opportunity to get out there in the power of God and see the dead raised up, to see the sick healed. Now, we want to do that in the flesh, but I'm telling you right now, a recent survey says that 10 out of 10 people are going to die. Okay, so you may get your healing today. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, I've seen it and I love it. But the reality of it is, this is going to pass. This whole thing is going to pass. Amen. And the Lord is going to return. So I want to encourage you, turn with me if you would to Hebrews chapter 7. As you're doing that, I'm going to turn to the book of John. Hebrews chapter 7 is going to be the text that we're going to be in today. And we're going to talk about Melchizedek, who he is. I want to share something with you about the Old Testament, how powerful it is. If you look for Jesus in the Old Testament, you'll find him. He is the thread that binds the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation. And if you don't see Jesus in this, you're missing something vital. I think reading the Old Testament is absolutely exciting because I'm constantly looking for Jesus. As I'm reading through, as I see the principles, it's all pointing to our Savior. Speaking about his saving graces. It's also talking about our Savior's justice and a coming judgment. And there is going to be a judgment for those who do not know Christ. And there is going to be rejoicing in heaven over those who do. And so last week we talked about risking it all. Do you remember that message? It stemmed from a dream that the Lord gave me that every man has a soul and is desperately crying out for salvation, regardless of what their mouths might say, their hands might do, or how they might walk. They need Jesus. And they are not going to know him unless you begin speaking life into them. Amen? So we have to get busy. Busy. So in John chapter 8, it's one of the times that Jesus says, I am. I am. There's seven other times in the book of John alone, and specifically to John, where Jesus says, I am. There's some significance in that. Amen. Some people said that Jesus never claimed to be God. Read your Bibles, my friends. He claimed to be God over and over again. As a matter of fact, the very reason that they wanted to stone him and kill him was blasphemy because he would equate himself to the Father. Not only saying that he was his Father, but making himself equal with the Father. And they wanted to stone him, and under the law, they were required to for blasphemy. Blasphemy. So in John chapter 6, multiple times, Jesus refers to himself, and I love how he says, I am the bread of life. You know, in all these things, I want you to know that if you're trying to almost tease somebody, it's like he's saying, I am, and they're like, the bread of life. Okay, what do you mean? You know, I am. Oh, he's doing it again. The light of the world. And then he gives us an understanding of what he means when he says, I am the bread of life. In John chapter 8, he says, I am the light of the world. In John chapter 10, he says, I am the door to the sheep gate. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man, he's getting bold with them. God in the flesh getting bold with man. My, oh, my. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except by me. That's a message that we need to tell the world, don't you think? It's not a politically correct message, though, is it? It gets a little ridicule. So somebody might say, if you said that, is Jesus the only way, John? You're telling me that Jesus, this Jesus, is the only way that I'm going to get to heaven. How narrow-minded is that? How bigoted is that, John? My, oh, my. That is non-inclusive. There you go. John, that statement is invading my safe space. Now, Jesus was sharing with them life, and he knew what they were doing. So many people want a different way. They want their way. Some people even claim to know Jesus, that they are a Christian, but they serve a different God. They say that I'm a Christian, I've given my life to Christ, but I don't think that he's the only way. I think that there's errors in the Bible, and I don't think that any of it's really credible. I think it's a man-made book of myths. Wow. But I'm probably a stronger Christian than you are. Amazing, isn't it? The society that we're in. In our society, I've just shared with you probably the worst that you're going to get. Was it too hard? Huh? John, I was pointing at you. I was really trying to get you to break. In other countries, that message can still get you stoned. We don't have that issue. We can do so much, my friends. We can do so much. And we should. And we should. So in John, hold your place there. Go to John chapter 8 with me just for a second. Hold your place in Hebrews chapter 7. Go to John chapter 8. Jesus has just shared with them that he is the light of the world. And in verse 56, let's go prior to that. So he says, I am the light of the world. And he is telling them, he was telling them the truth, and they hate it. They've even accused him that the works that he does through Satan, the devil. In verse 49, Jesus answered and says to them, I have not a devil, but I honor my Father, and you do dishonor me. And I seek not mine own glory. There is one that seeketh and judgeth. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keeps my sayings, he shall never see death. Then said the Jews unto him, now we know that you have a devil. Abraham is dead, and the prophets. And you say, if a man keep your sayings, my sayings, he shall never taste death. Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead? And the prophets are dead? Who do you make yourself out to be? Who are you saying that you are? And Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom you say that he is your God. Yet you have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar like you. But I know him and keep his sayings. Oh, this is big. Your father Abraham, listen, rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. My. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old. How have you seen Abraham? And Jesus said unto them, woo, this is it. This is the statement. Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Look what's after that, I am. All the other times, he says, light of the world, I am. He gets them. Notice how scriptures are not in error. And he says, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am, period. I don't know. It's pretty intense, don't you think? Jesus is God in the flesh. Amen? And he is alive today. Brother?
It ties back to the burning bush.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I mean, we can go into a lot of scriptures to break this down. There's no doubt about it. But here's the thing. If Jesus is the living God who came in the flesh, who ascended in a heavenly body, never having a body, now does, and Jesus says that no man has seen the Father except the Son. But then he says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. When you pray, when you focus in life, when you give your energies to something, to anything, those energies should be devoted to Jesus Christ. Even the Holy Spirit never glorifies himself and always points to who? Jesus. The Father has given all authority to who? Jesus. All of judgment will be done by who? Jesus. 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 He is the only way to the Father. And that is his own declaration. See, God gets to make the rules. He created everything. So when he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And if you want to know the Father, you got to go through me. Then that means that you're going to need to go through Jesus. Amen? That's simple. That is the message that the world needs. Amen? That's the message. That's it. In everything that we do, that is the message. But the Lord says in this passage of scripture, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Abraham saw Jesus. When? When? Turn with me to Genesis chapter 14. There are many different possibilities here that people will say or try to debate or prove who this person is. Some say that he is like a good Boaz. Others say that this is Shem. And spend a lot of time trying to prove it. Or some would say that this is a type, a good man who is a picture of Jesus. And I think that's close. Personally, I think that's close. Or this is a theophany, a Christophany, more than a type. Typology study, but this is the existence of Christ before his bodily form coming into existence in the flesh through the Virgin Mary, as prophesied, that Christ showed himself before. Now, this is one of many that I believe happened. Amen? Amen. One of many that I believe happened. But in this, chapter 14, Abram has gone to retrieve Lot and defeat kings. In verse 18, as they went there and defeated the kings that were fighting, there was 11 total, and ultimately they had captured Lot, his nephew, although in scripture it does say brother, but when you break it down, other places it said it's, obviously we know it's his nephew, but just like, you're my brother, AJ, you're not going to say, oh, it's a brother, I thought they were just friends, or are they cousins? Oh. Okay. You get it. So they had gone in with a small army, even split this group up, flanked them, beat the tar out of them, and then took their stuff, and then got their man, and then pulled it all out, and they're on their way back. And all of a sudden, and here's another interesting thing about Genesis, by the way. Everything that we read in the New Testament, there is something called the law of first mention. When you find its first place when it is mentioned in the Old Testament. Because in the New Testament, it is looking back. It is the revelation of the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, it's looking forward and it's concealed. You have to try to figure it out. They didn't actually understand it. Even the prophets only knew in part. And then ultimately, there was a full revelation that would take place. From what we read in the New Testament. So in this, all of a sudden, this is the first time that the name Melchizedek appears in the Bible. Who is Melchizedek? He's never mentioned before, and all of a sudden here he pops out on the scene as Abram is on his way back, and Abram identifies him and recognizes him as a high priest of the Most High God. Now listen, the high priest order had not yet been established until the law sometimes later, which actually picked up at Aaron. So this is pre-law priesthood that is very apparent to Abram. So this is before the law, and we'll get into that just a tad when we talk about something along the lines of testimony. But let me read verse 18. And Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be the Most High God, which hath delivered thine enemies into your hand. And he gave him tithes of all. And the king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the persons and take the goods to thyself. And Abram said to the king of Sodom, I lifted up my hand unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, that I will not take from a thread even to a shoe latchet, and that I will not take anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abram rich. Now, that's not a lot of information about Melchizedek at this point. It's the first time that he's mentioned, but there's a few things that stand out to me. I want you to know that Jesus Christ will reveal himself to you if you're looking for him. Amen? And I will tell you that he will choose to reveal himself even if you're not. Amen. This is God that we're talking about, who can do whatever he needs to do to accomplish his will and his purpose, even if we don't understand it, right? I don't understand why this is happening. I don't understand how this could happen. I don't understand why these things are plaguing me. I don't get it. Well, God's in control. Amen?
Amen.
God is in control. I'm telling you, you just have to trust Him. I look back even in my life, and there's been things that have happened, and there was no way that this could possibly be happening to me.
Amen.
That's the whole thing you're thinking. There's no way this could be happening. This can't be happening, Lord. Or why are you allowing this to happen? And it wasn't until later that God revealed it to me. Amen? Because, yeah, if at all. But there was times where I could see after time had passed that it was finally revealed to me. Because there were certain things that He wanted to do through me that I would not have done had He not brought those circumstances. Because I would have gone down a different road. And if He would have told me what I was going to need to do, I probably would have run. But He put me there and said, "This is what I have you to do." Amen? Now, as you go forward after several of those experiences, you start to say yes and amen. You just get there.
Amen.
Yes and amen.
Amen.
Brother's car gets totaled earlier this week.
Have your way, Lord.
And he's over, "Have your way." Yes and amen. Lord, I'm waiting to see what you said even this morning. I'm waiting to see how you redeem this situation.
Amen.
That it is going to be for His good and God's glory. That's His definition of being redeemed. I love it. I love it. I love some of those definitions. Give me more. If you weren't here, I'd take credit for it. Isn't God good?
Amen.
God is good. This should be how we're talking with people and engaging people. And it's not a spirit of fear that we should have. We should be telling people about the living God who lives in us and can give them redemption through His name.
Amen.
Through His name.
The name.
That they can be washed in the blood of Christ.
Amen.
That their sins can be forgiven,
Amen.
That the yoke of bondage can be lifted.
Yes, Lord.
And they want that.
Yes, they do.
They want that. There's a lot more people that will engage you in a conversation wanting that than will reject it.
Yes, freedom in Jesus.
We just don't do it.
Amen.
And people just don't know.
Mm.
They need people speaking truth, speaking truth. There's a few things that are here, and then we're going to go to our source text here. This is just a little background. This is the law of first mention. And we're going to talk about three things that are drawn out of this scripture as we get into seven. One, we're going to talk about time. The time that we spend. Where do we spend it?
Yes.
We're going to talk about treasure. Mm-hmm. Amen? Because you see that here in the scriptures. And we're going to talk about our testimony and how those two empower the third. The first two empower the third. Amen? So go with me to chapter 7 of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 7. And we get a little bit more information about this. 5 has a little bit about it as well. And it speaks twice about the order of Melchizedek. That Jesus Christ is the high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Now, when you just read in Genesis, you don't really get anything except that this was a man recognized as a high priest of God and that he blessed Abram and that he received tithes from Abram. And many don't actually even know what tithes are in the Old Testament, but a tithe is actually a tenth, is what it means. It's the translation. And then in 7, it speaks a little bit more about it. Verse 1. For Melchizedek, the king of Salem, as we read, priest of the Most High God, we get it, who met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. We read that. To whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all. There's the tenth, the tithe, the tenth. First being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace, without father, without mother, without descendant, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. Now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils. Now let's stop just for a minute, because we can technically read through the rest of this to get more, and we'll draw it out as the Holy Spirit leads and as we go. This person here, if he was Shem, has a genealogy. Shem had a genealogy, amen? Shem's dad was Noah, right? So just that seems to fall apart unless you just kind of pull it out and say, well, it's just kind of like a type, and he's just meaning that, I don't know what you're meaning, because no one would ever describe me as not having a father or a mother or a beginning of time or end of time, right? As just a mortal. I mean, we all have a genealogy. That's a strange way to describe him. What do you got, brother?
Well, I mean, in the Hebraic mindset, genealogy was everything.
Very true.
And Paul was Pharisee, so you'd think if he was really Shem, he would actually...
He would have nailed it, right? Yeah, because genealogy is huge. People are bored by reading the genealogies. When we get to the Bible, they're like, oh, man, these guys are way too serious about this genealogy stuff. Let me skip 2, 3, 4, 5 pages. Boy, they're just spending too much time on this. There's an amazing message in the genealogy, by the way. Whew, I'm telling you, powerful. You look for Jesus, you're going to find him. I'm telling you, it's powerful. We'll have to do that later. But here's a few things that we can see from this. King of righteousness. Who would that be? Or the king of peace, having no beginning or end, or descendants, or beginning of days, nor an end of life. And most certainly he was a type of Christ, but this was Christ before he came in the flesh. So this is where, you know, they say it's a type, but not Christ himself. I believe that this was Jesus Christ, pre-incarnate, that met with Abraham on his way back, revealing himself and kind of setting the stage. How awesome is that? For the future, for us to be able to see it. And there's some other things in here that really kind of draw it out, but there's a few things that, well, let me just continue reading then. Verse 4, now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of his spoils, and verily that they are the sons of Levi who received the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take the tithes from the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descendant is not counted from them received tithes from Abraham and blessed him and that had the promises, and without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. Why would he give tithes before he was ever commanded? Maybe it was already established, even as we go all the way back to Cain and Abel, that there were offerings that were made that were acceptable and unacceptable. Amen? Now, I think even in the New Testament, we can actually draw out some things about offerings. But I know that we're in an age where there's one of two things. One, a lot of people tithe and give offerings to churches, and you see that they're big churches. And somehow those churches are always talking about tithes and offerings, and they grow these big giant buildings, and they do all kinds of stuff. And the pastors and the ministers are flying around the world in jets, living in $6 million homes, fleecing the flock as they go. And then the other half is, I ain't giving nothing. Or I'll give what I think it's valuable. That we don't have to give in the New Testament a tenth. And oftentimes, they go so far as to say that and give less not more. It's not about giving out of abundance, but out of absolute necessity that they give, to a point that they feel a little bit guilty that they haven't done more. That's really kind of the other side. Those are the extremes. And then there would be something in between. Now, I don't know about you, but the kingdom grows how? Through the saving of souls. Amen? It's true, right? So let's talk about this. The very first thing that Abraham did was he took the time to recognize God in the flesh. I shouldn't say in the flesh. Pre-incarnate. Amen? Let's talk about Abraham. He took the time to do the things that God wanted him to do. And I don't think it showed anywhere in there where God was asking for his money. As a matter of fact, it looked like he was going to give him more. And he said, I don't want to take anything additional because I'm afraid that people are going to say that you made me rich. And I want to make sure that all the glory goes to God. He didn't fully recognize who he was talking to, the provider of all things. Amen. But with his time, he most certainly took it to identify that God needed to talk with him. Amen. And God needs to speak to us as well regarding our time. You know, there's three things. I think you might have shared this with me at one point in time. I feel like it's mine now. Yes. But there's only a few things that we really have that we can utilize in this world. And one is going to be our financial resources, right? The thing about financial resources is they're quantifiable. We know how much we have or don't have. We know when it ends. We can budget it. We see when it's coming and when it's going, and we can manage it. And that's nice. We should use that for the kingdom. And then you have an emotional capacity, right? You've dealt with people before. And some people are emotional vampires. You come around them and they're just constantly sucking your emotional capacity to a place where you have to cut it off because that's reserved for your sound being, you know, your own mental wellness. I have to break away now. I can't talk to you anymore. But you know how much of that you have because when you hit the bottom, you get it. You know that you're at the bottom and you need to rest, you need to recuperate. Well, when it comes to time, this is the most valuable of all assets that we've been given because we only have a certain amount of time, but we have no earthly idea how much of it we have. It's the only one that we can't quantify. So we should use it wisely. We should manage it well. And the time that we have should be an investment in kingdom treasures. Amen?
Amen?
We spend a lot of time at work. I get it. We want to do that for the glory of Christ, and he's given us that. To do what, though? To be able to utilize our time that we have for watching football, of course. Or other things. You know, I'm all for taking your kids to a soccer game, but when you're spending so much of your time engaged in so many other activities that are not building the kingdom, then I'm telling you, it's a waste of time. If you're taking your kids to a soccer game, but you're not teaching them about Christ, you're killing your children. That's pretty extreme, isn't it? I've heard people tell me, well, I'm going to let my kids make a decision on their own. I'm not going to force my religion on them or my relationship if they go a little bit further and they speak very fluid Christianese. That's a shame. We're supposed to be raising up our children in the way that they should go. And, you know, sports, I'm all for them, and it's great to get out of the house and It's wonderful to spend time with your children, but we need to be focusing our time on the most important things in this life. Now, here's a problem with the church today in America, is we have got too much freedom, too much time to do whatever we want to do, and there's no dependency on God because we can depend on ourselves, our bank accounts, our jobs, our cars, our families, our friends, anything, everything. We can get advice and wisdom from the world on a pick up your phone, Facebook a problem. You'll have a million people telling you what to do and what you need to do. Sort out which one feels like it's the best one, it's going to cost the least amount of sacrifice, and then go with it. And then make it all about you and make sure that you store up as much as you can for yourself in this life because, hey, you're an American and you've got rights and you can do whatever you want to do. Now, that's supposed to be a blessing, amen? But we're watching how our society is spiraling literally out of control because parents didn't spend time enough with their kids, or people didn't petition their government, local municipalities, to keep Bibles and prayer in school when they got pulled out. To make sure that we can voice our opinions that a man that thinks he's a woman has a mental problem and needs help. Say it. It's okay. It's all right to say that. If I sat up here one Sunday and said, I'm a dog and barked the whole time, you'd get me help, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you? I hope so. I'm a dog. No, you're not. You're a man. I'm a woman. No, you're not. You're a man. I'm a tree. No, you're not. You're getting weird, but you're still a guy. Right? We should be able to speak truth into people's lives. It's not out of hatred. Listen, there is a serious issue here, man. You somehow think that you're a woman, but everything is saying that you're not. And it's happening the opposite way. And that's becoming normal, my friends. We need to spend more time about the work of the gospel and truth than we need to be spending on anything else. Because I'll tell you right now, according to Scripture, I know what's next. If we're going to normalize homosexuality and transgenderism, then we're going to normalize bestiality at some point. And pedophilia and incest and necrophilia. Because, hey, the guy loves his dog that he thinks is a girl and wants to have, you know, the last moments with that significant other, even though they've died. I mean, it just gets morbid. Morbid. It's a warped thinking. And we're not spending our time sharing enough about the gospel and truth. You know, there was a man who turned from the homosexual lifestyle. And they say that it's something that they're born with, like their race. And it's not true, because a black man or an Asian man or a white man is never going to change from being that. They can't be redeemed out of being white or black or Asian. It's something that they are. You can't change it. So the association that they've made, even with, you know, race equality, for instance, that's a big issue today, is false. It's a false pretense. Listen, this is a choice on your part. You know, my color is not a choice. God made me this way, and I'm very glad. I'm happy. And I pray whatever he made you, whatever color he made you, that you're happy with it. Amen? You should be. You're made in God's image. And I don't think because we're all made in God's image, I don't think color was a big issue. Right? But he did make us different, man and woman. And so anyway, we need to be sharing the truth, spending our time. Now, he spent time with the Lord to find out what was good and what was right. And so should we. And we need to make sure that our time is spent well on the Word. Our friends in Pakistan spend quite a bit more time in prayer where they dedicate themselves for days in fasting together, banding together. And they've been praying that the Lord would open doors for them to share the gospel. And Asher, this week on Monday, got a phone call from the only Christian television show in the area for the work that's being done there, and asked him to come on, interviewed him, and he was proclaiming the gospel and the necessity for people to get active in evangelism, which is illegal, in their communities for Christ, because he lives. He is alive, and he can redeem you. He can transform you. He can make everything better, if not in this life, in the one to come. That's powerful.
Amen.
Amen? Their time is focused more on the Lord and his work that he's called us to than we do. And that should change, because we have more liberties, right? Seemingly. Persecution causes some amazing things. So at least wish a halfway decent-sized asteroid would have hit the Earth yesterday and caused some problems, or a solar flare would have knocked out some power somewhere. Just, you know, in Houston and in Florida right now, you've got people that are trying to band together, and you've got others that are against them, stealing their things. We have a phenomenal person with us even today that experienced a lot of that heartache of having to abandon their life for something new. Brenda's with us today, and thank you. Thank you for being here. When we spend time focused on what the Lord needs, I'm telling you right now, or what he wants, we begin to see what God wants. When we spend time trying to find out what he wants, we begin to see it. And there's no grudging spirit about it. There's no, oh my goodness, I can't believe I've got to do this. This is going to set me back, or whatever it is. If God wants you to do something, then he's going to make the provision and he's going to provide the protection as you walk through that. And when you trust him in faith, I'm telling you right now, it's amazing some of the things that you'll actually see. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but it will be amazing. I assure you. So then we come to this part where when he's spending his time with the Lord, he's asked to do something, or he's compelled to do something that wasn't already prescribed, and that was to give him an offering of the spoils. Not to take anything from him, because it did seem like he was going to give him even more. He says, no, I want you to have this, and then I don't want anyone to know that you wanted to even do that, because I want it to be all glory to God that he's the one, if I become rich, made me rich. Not anyone that he's perceiving to be a man. By the way, even when the law was established, no king was allowed to be a priest, right? And then here we have a king who is a priest. And when the law was finally established, he said, that can't happen, because I don't want you to get mixed up with my son. Because that is a continual priesthood. Now, here's the amazing thing here. You have the law that was established through Moses, but prior to that, you already had some form of a system where God was speaking to, talking with, revealing himself, and showing himself as the Son of God, or likened unto the Son of God. Where even these terms were coming from is amazing at this point in time. But he was revealing himself as a continual priesthood and king prior to the law. A continual priesthood. So then he introduced another one, which was the Levitical law and the priesthood that began with Aaron and moving forward, and the Levites, for a period of time to do what? To do what? To point to who? To point a need for what? It's a solution. Listen, you're missing everything. You establish this that points to Christ. It's established in such a way that you can't do it. You can't accomplish it. So he's going to establish a priesthood that has an infirmity that is going to die and is going to have to continue, but it won't continue like this priesthood he's talking about, the Melchizedek priesthood. And so the law was established as a schoolmaster to point to Jesus. And then Jesus came, and then now here you have in the scriptures in verse 15. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. For he testifieth, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. For there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before for the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. For the law made nothing perfect, but it bringeth in of a better, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. And inasmuch as not without an oath, he was made priest. For those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a what kind of a testament?
A better
testament. And they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. It never changed, folks. Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing that he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sin, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For he did once when he offered up himself. For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forever. You know what this book's about? Jesus. Start to finish. Now, one of the things that God actually showed him, and I believe that Melchizedek is God basically in the flesh, pre-incarnate, keep saying that, pre-incarnate, he asked him to give a tithe. He was compelled to give a tithe. Now, here's one thing I know about offerings and tithes. Whether you believe that tithes exist today, they exist at least in the Old Testament and predating the law, and they were happening in the New Testament. And Jesus even said at one point that don't stop giving the tithes, but you are lacking other things. Do these things as well. Operate in love and mercy and truth. And then there were those that would go out like Paul, who went and gathered resources for the church at Jerusalem, even saying that when I get there, I will receive of those offerings so that we can bring it to them. Even Paul said, I don't receive an offering from you, because he's talking to the church at Corinth. You guys are ate up. You know, he didn't say it that way, but he wasn't going to receive money from them because he knew it would be a stumbling block for them. Because them giving him any money would have caused them to think that either A, they owned him, which they didn't, or that they could dictate what he does, which they didn't. It was God who gave him commands. But he didn't want it to be tied up with money, because their faith was weak and their association was to stuff and goodies and things like this. And he was trying to pull them away from idolatry. And it was a difficult thing. So when it comes to this, I'm not going to dictate to you what should be done with your money. But what I do know is that a person that has difficulties giving money, to ministry work first has a problem giving their hearts to God. That's a reality that we face. I don't talk a lot about money or treasures or tithing, and it's for a reason. Because I don't want to be associated with the charlatans for filthy lucre that want to buy jets and big homes and have two or three houses on an island and whatnot. However, I will assure you that I don't have a jet and I don't have a big home. I've got a 1,388 square foot home. And I know that ministry takes God's people to actually give with a cheerful heart. That's what it takes. And there are a lot of ministries, and even in this ministry, that the cheer must be low. I'm just sharing that with you because we have things that we can do. But yet people are holding on to greenbacks that God has already designated for something else. And they have some kind of preconceived thoughts that it's going to go towards something that they're not going to approve that the church is doing. If CrossLife, for instance, were to be doing something that you did not like, then go to a church that is doing what you like. Give there. Because right now, I can tell you right now, there are people in this room that will hear this message and probably come if they knew this. And then people that are not here that need financial resources to get back on their feet. They need financial resources to make sure that they have transportation for ministry. That they need financial resources so that people can eat food without begging the government for it. That we have helped people with their rent. We have helped to host events that cost money to do so that people could get saved. Amen. That we want to be able to buy Bibles. That we want to send money to Pakistan so that they can actually function as a church. They give everything they've got. They put their stuff together, folks, to make ends meet as a church. When people come into the church in Pakistan, they give to them the things that they have. The two-coat thing, they give the coat. You don't have a place to stay? I got you covered. You need some food? Come to my house. I'll feed you. You need a ride? You need whatever it is? They're working together as a body. We have to start doing more of that as a church.
Yes, amen.
As a church,
amen.
We should be doing that. So I'll tell you right now, where your treasure is, there will your heart be. And again, it's not about greenbacks and money. It's about your heart. That's why God said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be. And some people are against tithing. Other people are for tithing. And they wouldn't miss it. I'll tell you my testimony. I got saved, and I didn't know anything about tithe, but I started giving money to the church because I liked what was going on in my life, and I liked what was happening there. I liked that I was encouraged. I liked that I was empowered. I liked the fact that I liked every time the doors were open, I wanted to be there. I wanted to be an usher. I wanted to talk about scripture from the pulpit if they let me. Don't have to. I want to stand at the door and greet people as they come in. I want to make sure that my resources are going to more people getting what I got. Amen? And then the pastor told me something crazy. He said, it's only a tenth. I was like, what? I've been given 40 and 50% and money. I don't even know what I'm doing anymore. Oh, we got to pay bills. The Lord's figuring it out. Praise God. But you just give where it is. You want to talk about cheerful giving? Amen. That was kind of a downer that he said tenth. I was like, oh, I guess a tenth. I mean, can we get it done? There's so much work to do. You see the difference?
Yes.
The cheerful giver. As opposed to a grudgingly giving. Yeah. You know, the widow gave everything that she had, and the Pharisee put in, and Jesus said that the two pennies that she put in was far more because she gave. She gave up everything, trusting in God. I don't know. A meteor may come. They're saying they moved it from yesterday to like the 11th, okay? Nothing like extending your ministry, right? What if you only had a couple of weeks left? Sitting on your money, would that be awesome?
No.
To go and enter into the presence of the Lord with a nice, healthy bank account? Hey, listen, I'm not telling you to sell everything. I've seen people that have done that because they bought into the fear-mongering that people are doing to get them to do stupid stuff. Be prepared. Be prepared. Be wise. Take care of your family. How long into the tribulation can I go, O Lord? You know, that's good stuff. But I'm telling you right now, there are things that need to be done. Scientology is well-funded. The Catholic Church is well-funded. Islam is well-funded. Christianity, not very well-funded. I'm just saying. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be. So he gave a tenth. Some people give more. The average, according to the Barna study, that petitioners of churches, evangelical churches, claiming that Christ is the only way, give 1% of their income. That's what it is. That's the average, 1%. That means some people give more and some people give less. Less than 1%, pretty impressive. No, it's not. Well, I'm glad that you asked about tithing.
Thank you for answering.
But one of the things that you'll see here is he wanted to give a testimony to God. That's ultimately what he wanted to do. I don't want to take anything from anybody because I want it to be a provision of the Lord, that God did it. Obviously, he didn't know exactly who he was talking to at the time because God is the provider. Amen? He is the one that makes provision. But as we've talked about our time and our treasure, I'll tell you right now, you start spending your time in kingdom work and your treasures on kingdom building, and you're going to have a very powerful testimony of what God is doing in your life and through your life. Amen? Your testimony will not center on or be focused on the law. It will be focused on Jesus Christ and his kingdom. This is the whole point that Paul is trying to make here in Hebrews chapter 7. He's saying that this is about Christ, a continual priesthood that started and predated the law that was there. The law happened, and we couldn't do it because it was pointing to Christ who could. He's the one that we need to rest in and put everything into, all of our time, all of our treasure. Make every testimony a testimony to Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
That is what we're supposed to be doing. And that is just a focus there on Hebrews chapter 7. This is, who is Melchizedek? I think Melchizedek was God. Pre-incarnate God. So, here's the questions for the application. You apply them as they fit. Where is your time spent? Is your time spent on work? Predominantly, that's the major focus. I know how difficult it is. I've started a business, and I'm pulled to and fro. I sometimes don't feel like I have a choice, that I have to be somewhere at this time because someone did something or something broke, and it has to be dealt with. And so I feel like I'm going through this. But here's the amazing thing. As I'm going through this, I'm trusting that God is in control.
Yes. Yes.
And I'm seeing that all these points and places where I have to be, there is opportunity.
Yes, there is.
To share my testimony.
Amen.
That there's opportunity to spend my time with someone, although we may be working, like even Wednesday night. I was working on repairing a 40-foot pole on the side of a vehicle so that we could roll the tarp. And a gentleman came out here that I was able to minister to and encourage in Christ. And he needed it. He needed it. It wasn't by accident that the pole broke, that this man needed to come out and talk with me. It was a welded pole that snapped. I'm like, how does that happen? Well, it happens. Yeah, you use it, But it happens because God is setting up for us to spend time on his kingdom, on his people, and on the building of his kingdom. Amen? Where is your time spent? Again, it is a quantifiable amount of time. But wherever you spend most of your time is what's driving you. And so, you know, work occupies a lot of our time, maybe 40 or plus hours. Sleeping, another 40 plus hours. And that's actually more. We probably spend more time sleeping than we do work, unless you stay up all weekend. But in the times that you have, what are you doing? Where are you spending it? Secondly, where is your treasure stored? Where's your treasure?
Yes.
Even me talking about tithes to some people makes their stomach churn, and they want to debate me and argue and fight, and they don't want to have to do it. I want to be able to be a cheerful giver of 1% like everybody else. Man, give. Give. I tell you what, if I was at a different church and I was preaching to a different church, I would talk about the perils and pitfalls for your pastor. And I would talk about the reality that most churches don't even realize what their pastors are going through. And I've preached it at other churches, of the roller coasters that they go through. But one of the things that's amazing is most churches starve their pastors, and they don't see them successful. Maybe Joel Osteen and T.D. Jakes and some of these big churches that are preaching the word of faith stuff. But I'm telling you, for the most part, the ministers, the ones that the church really counts on being there when the crisis happens, the ones that they need to drop everything and come to my aid, the ones where the discipleship is something that nobody knows about, nobody cares about, except the pastor sees a person that needs to be counseled out of something, or a couple needs to be moved to a closer relationship with Christ. None of this is really seen. None of it. And most don't care. Now, the church should at least try to take care of the ones that minister to them. A man can stand there and preach the gospel. A man can lead people to a closer relationship through Christ, through worship. And yet, those men, without you knowing, could be hungry, starving, keeping a good, joyful spirit, but nobody really knows what's going on in their life. At least, this is why he says, give to the church first. Even the priests, as we see in the law, took of the offerings. And those that preach the gospel should live by the gospel and not live by some secular job. But some have to, because that's how they take care of their families. It's not done for filthy lucre. It's done out of love. I'll tell you right now, for the longest time, I never took anything. I remember the first year that Cross Life was established, $20,000 of the $30,000 of the offerings was my tithe to the church so that we could be at the Hilton. Yeah, the Hilton. Well, we were at the golf course first, and we had to pay for that, but at the Hilton. And it was just, it's love. It's done out of love. And if I was poor and lived under a bridge, I assure you I'd be here on Sunday. And I would preach the glorious gospel of the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ under the bridge before I came here. Amen. And then I'd come here. And I'd probably keep my suits on a hanger under the bridge so that I could come in here and know that we actually operate out of victory.
That's right. Yes.
Not for victory, but from victory.
Yeah.
That we are victorious in all things, regardless of the circumstances. We serve the living King.
Amen.
Amen. We serve the high priest who always has room at his altar to forgive us, to restore us, to redeem us. Lastly, does your testimony sound like that? Regardless of the circumstances or what's going on, does your testimony show power and demonstration? Well, your time and your treasures will help set your testimony. Because what you spend time on is what you're dedicated to. And what you spend money on is what you're devoted to. And I'll tell you right now, a testimony without demonstration sometimes happens because we got the first two wrong. So the Lord wants us to get aligned, amen? Because I'm telling you right now, He knows everything about us. He knows when the last moment is. He knows where we spend our time, and He knows where we spend our treasure. And He knows when we leave here how powerful your testimony is or how it's lacking. I'm telling you right now, it's an amazing thing when you walk up to somebody and you know that they have a need, and you go ahead and meet them right where they are with a $20 bill. It's just 20 bucks. It's a piece of paper. You make plenty of them. They're sitting all around for most, and you just hand it to them, and they're like, what's this for? Have you ever handed a piece of paper to somebody and them start crying on your shoulder? There's a lady walking by me one time. The Lord had me put several hundred dollars in my pocket to give away, just to give away. And I knew that He would tell me when. A lady's walking by the front of the truck, and the Lord said, her. And I rolled the window, and I said, ma'am, yes. And she had a nice outfit on. She was walking down the street, and you couldn't tell that she was homeless. She didn't try to confront me with anything. She started walking up, and I said, ma'am, but the Lord told me right before. And she had, I told this before, but she had some change in her hand. She said she's trying to catch a bus. She stays at a place. She's barely making anything, and she just wanted me to change these coins into dollars so that she could get on the bus, because the bus driver was giving her a hard time, and she was getting enough hard time trying to live out of a motel, you know, and keep a job and trying to get back on her feet. And I said, wow. And I said, here you go. And gave her $100. And she started crying over my shoulder. And I just start saying, the Lord loves you. The Lord sees what you're doing. Yes. The Lord is walking with you. And she just started crying. She was like, I know. I've been telling them. And I've been telling them what I need. And what I was, you know, it was pretty awesome. The little experience there. And it just brought a lot of joy and hope to her. For me to be able to give me an opportunity to speak life into her, it gave me an opportunity to stop and take some time with her and to invest some treasure in her so I could share this testimony with you so that you can empower to do the same thing. Be empowered to go and do the same thing. Amen? It's pretty amazing. I've taken up enough of our time. So, take time to meet with God as your first priority. Give God your heart, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And these actions of faith, I assure you, will build an amazing testimony. I'd like to take the time tonight at Sunday at 5 for you to, between now and then, go and make a testimony. Amen. Make a testimony this afternoon. You're going to be at lunch. You're going to see the waitress. Everybody's going to be fighting to give her a tip that equals the bill, to bless her and maybe write a note, or him, write a note on it. Or stop off and get gas and see someone and just go and pay for somebody's fuel for them right there at the pump. Just bless them. Stand in line at the grocery store as you're getting some goodies for the house. Buy somebody's groceries. Allow the Holy Spirit to give you some discernment here. Don't buy everybody's groceries unless the Lord leads you to. It's amazing when you start looking for those opportunities to share the gospel, when you're looking to share your time, when you're looking to share your treasures with them, when God's going to build a testimony, amen? God's going to build a testimony. You'll begin to overhear conversations in the line, oh, ma'am, your WIC card, your Lone Star card doesn't have enough on it. Yeah. Well, we'll just put the baby formula back and this. I'm telling you what, if the Holy Spirit doesn't get a hold of you in that moment, can you feel Him? Can you feel Him drawing you to a situation like that to build that kind of a testimony? Where you'll go, no. Formula stays on. Put the diapers back, both of them. Both of them. All of them. Is this it? You see what I'm saying? Why are you doing this for me? That's what Sunday at 5 is all about when we go on Sundays. And it's difficult for some of us. Listen, I'm tired, guys, personally. Yeah. I planned on telling AJ that I wasn't going to be able to make it tonight because I just need to rest. Because I put in 15, 16 hours a day and study and minister and we do this. And it's just long. It's always. It's every day. It's 7 days. Ministry is 7 days. It's no time off. There's nothing. You just go and you go and you go and you go. And we should take time to rest. And I need to get this Sabbath thing down. I hope I didn't lose my salvation and stuff. But but I want to be there. I want to see the testimonies. I want to lift my hands on high to the Lord. Amen. And I'm encouraging us as a church to go build a testimony. I know it's inconvenient worshiping the Lord and such on a Sunday night. I know that it's inconvenient going out in the afternoon and going and letting God build a testimony for you. Spending some time. Tell you right now, if the Lord was going to return on the 11th now, or some cataclysmic event was going to take place on October 11th, and it may. We don't know. North Korea's pretty out of control. Rocket Man, he's serious. Right? What would you be doing for the Lord if you knew that he was going to return on the 11th? Would it be about, oh, I just want to chill out and sit at home? Need to make sure that my bank account's nice and full. Listen, I'm not saying exhaust your bank account, but I am saying that look among yourselves right now. There's needs right here in this room. There's needs right here in this room. We can't overlook those things. You can build a testimony right here.